Why is trigger point pain so intense, and why does it become chronic? Depolarization, in response to the irritating chemicals from muscle trigger point damage, spread along the dendrites of the muscle nociceptors. Dendrites from muscle trigger point nociceptors join with dendrites from undamaged muscles and visceral organs to form an afferent sensory nerve that leads to a sensory root ganglion located near the spinal column between the vertebrae. Here is a cross-sectional view of the vertebra and spinal cord with the root ganglion associated with our muscle trigger point. The spinal cord is located in the vertebral foramen, surrounded by a protective cushion of fat and connective tissue. The cell bodies of the nociceptors are located in the root ganglion and give rise to axons that form into a series of sensory nerve rootlets that connect to the spinal cord. Within the sensory nerve rootlet are myelinated axons of the A delta fibers and unmyelinated axons of C fibers from the muscle trigger point, along with axons from nociceptors that are not detecting pain. The pain signals in the afferent C and A delta fibers from the muscle trigger point are conveyed from the dorsal root ganglion along axons inside a sensory nerve rootlet. Also in the sensory nerve rootlet are inactive axons of nociceptors from other muscles and internal organs that are not in pain. Axons in the sensory nerve rootlet enter the spinal cord through the dorsal horn. Here is a magnification of the structural and neurological relationships within the dorsal horn. Nociceptors undergo synapse with dorsal horn relay neurons, which interpret their pain signals before transmitting them to the brain. This model represents three theoretical fields of relay neurons for different nociceptors. The center field receives the pain signals from the C and A delta nociceptors of our muscle trigger point. The two outer fields are innervated by sensory nerve rootlets from undamaged muscles or internal organs that are inactive and not conveying pain signals. Incoming nociceptors synapse with relay neurons in each field, and the axons from the postsynaptic relay neurons form a nerve that crosses to the contralateral side of the spinal cord before joining an ascending spinothalamic nerve that carries the pain signals to the brain. Here is a magnification of the area of synapse for the nociceptors to illustrate how the pain signals from a muscle trigger point change the functioning and wiring of dorsal horn postsynaptic neurons to produce chronic pain. This is the field of relay neurons that synapse with the C and A delta nociceptors to transfer their pain perception into the central nervous system. The C and A delta nociceptors synapse with relay neurons near the outer edge of the dorsal horn. These primary relay neurons project the pain signals directly to the brain along the contralateral and spinothalamic ascending pathways. The C fibers also synapse with neurons that transfer their signals to so-called wide dynamic neurons that are located deeper within the dorsal horn. A delta fibers synapse directly with the wide dynamic neurons as well. Wide dynamic projection neurons communicate with the brain through the spinothalamic pathway and are responsive to all peripheral somatosensory inputs of any intensity, both painful and non-painful. With persistent trigger point injury in the muscle, repeated nociceptor input causes a progressively greater sensitivity in the dorsal horn neurons by the continuous release of neurotransmitter chemicals. A delta fibers release glutamate, and C fibers release both glutamate and substance P as neurotransmitter chemicals at their synapses with dorsal horn neurons. The constant release of glutamate and substance P exceeds the normal processes for their removal, and glutamate and substance P accumulate and flood adjacent dorsal horn neurons. The excess glutamate and substance P stimulate cation channels to open in inactive circuit neurons of the dorsal horn that are normally silent. Here is a magnification of the membrane surface for such a silent neuron to illustrate how trigger point pain can change the functions of the dorsal horn neurons and recruit them for pain amplification. Glutamate activates AMPA receptors, and glutamate, along with substance P, activate NMDA receptors. These two glutamate-responsive receptors both open dormant cation channels. Opening cation channels allows calcium flow into the previously inactive dorsal horn neurons. The intracellular calcium stimulates existing sodium channels to open for depolarization and impulse generation in the newly activated silent neurons. Subsequently, substance P also binds neurokinin 1 G-protein-coupled receptors for intracellular signaling of gene expression that results in the synthesis of additional new active sodium channels. Therefore, glutamate and substance P increase both the number and activity of the sodium channels and convert previously inactive silent dorsal horn neurons into neurons that are now hyperexcitable. Let us return to the dorsal horn view and see other effects of muscle pain on the central nervous system. Also in the dorsal horn are inhibitory neurons that suppress normal pain signals through feedback mechanisms from the brain. However, the glutamate and substance P-induced calcium influx is cytotoxic to the inhibitory neurons and activates apoptotic processes that result in their death. Therefore, glutamate and substance P increase both the number and activity of the sodium channels over extended times and turn the previously inactive silent dorsal horn neurons into sensitive hyperexcitable neurons. The hyperexcitation is called windup and decreases pain thresholds, resulting in elevated pain with or without additional stimulus. Finally, the afferent nociceptor fibers carrying pain signals can grow new spinal terminals, thereby broadening their synaptic connections to adjacent inactive synaptic regions. Let us return to the dorsal horn overview to see the impact of these events on the perception and interpretation of pain in the central nervous system. The persistent cascade of neurotransmitter chemicals, combined with the spread of neuronal connections, expands the pain field from its initial hypersensitized neurons to encompass adjoining postsynaptic neurons for regions of the body that are healthy and are not receiving pain signals. These inactive postsynaptic neurons in the expanded pain field also begin to signal the brain through their contralateral and ascending spinothalamic nerves, as if their nociceptors were also detecting pain, even though their nociceptors are actually from undamaged areas of the body. The perception of a new false painful area is called referred pain and is a common feature of the myofascial pain syndrome. These overall changes are called lesion-induced functional reorganization of the dorsal horn and can occur within hours of the onset of peripheral muscle pain. They are long-lasting and may be permanent, and convert the dorsal horn from responding to single incidents of localized acute pain to a state of widespread permanent excitation, perceived as pervasive chronic pain. Let us return to the spinal column and follow the pain signals up the ascending spinothalamic pathway to the brain, and describe how pain is perceived within the brain and how pain affects brain functions. Here we see the spinal cord and the interior of its contralateral side containing the ascending spinothalamic axons from the dorsal horn postsynaptic neurons that receive the nociceptor input from the muscle trigger point. The brain is faded to an interior longitudinal section to see how it is affected by pain signals. Pain signals in the nociceptor ascending fibers of the spinothalamic nerve undergo synapse with relay neurons in the thalamus region. Neurons from the thalamus spread the pain signals to other regions of the brain, such as the amygdala, prefrontal cortex, insula, and the anterior cingulate, that are involved in cognition and complex emotion. This likely explains why chronic pain can cause problems such as poor judgment and decision-making, sleep disruption, fear, and depression. Now that we have described muscle trigger points and how they form and produce chronic pain, let us turn our discussion to the relief of muscle trigger point pain by the treatment of dry needling.